Well, it's been a fascinating morning, and I think it will progress and heat up even more this afternoon. Our next keynote speaker speaks on the policy challenges in implementing sustainable development goals. It's Professor Xue Lan, and to introduce him, we're very honored to have with us this afternoon Professor John Thwaites, a professorial fellow from the Monash University and chair of ClimateWorks Australia and the Monash Sustainable Development Institute. He chairs the Australian Building Codes Board, Melbourne Water, and the Peter Cullen Water and Environment Trust. He has advised state and local governments on climate change and energy policy. John Thwaites was Deputy Premier of Victoria from 1999 until his retirement in 2007, although he looks much too young to be retired. As Minister for Health, Minister for Planning, Minister for Environment, Water, Victorian Communities, and Victoria's first Minister for Climate Change in this period, he was responsible for major reforms in social policy, health, environment, and water. He was a councillor for the City of South Melbourne and Mayor in 1991 and 1992, and he has degrees in law and science. So please welcome Professor John Thwaites.
Well, thank you very much, Jasmine, and salamat tengahari. Good afternoon, everyone. It's marvellous to be here. I'm amazed by these microphones. I always wanted to be in a rock band, and this is about as close as I'm ever going to get. But I know that Jeff was with Sting once and liked that as well. Yesterday afternoon, I had the opportunity to be at the Malaysia Sustainable Development Solutions Network meeting, the SDSN, chaired by Professor Zachary. And Professor Zachary said at that meeting that there are three I's for the Sustainable Development Goals: implementation, implementation, and implementation. And so it's very appropriate this afternoon that we're going to hear from Professor Xue Lan about policy challenges for implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals. Professor Xue Lan has an extraordinary biography, which I'm going to talk a little bit about in a moment, but he is in demand all around the world, so much so I understand that he this morning was woken at 6 to be driven to a radio station to do a radio interview in KL about China and policies that affect sustainable development. So right around the world, he is known as a global expert. Professor Xue Lan is the Shung Kong Chair Professor and Dean of the School of Public Policy and Management at Tsinghua University. He has a PhD in public policy from Carnegie Mellon University. He taught at the George Washington University before returning back to China in 1996. His teaching and research interests include public policy analysis, science, technology, innovation, crisis management, and global governance. And he's published widely in all those areas. Professor Xue Lan also serves as an adjunct professor at Carnegie Mellon University and a non-resident senior fellow at the Brookings Institution. His many public service appointments include a member of the National Committee for Strategic Consultation and Comprehensive Review, a member of the Expert Committee on Emergency Management of the State Council of China, Vice President of the China Association of Public Administration, a member of the United Nations University Council, a member of the Visiting Committee for the Harvard Kennedy School, and a member of the Academic Advisory Board of the Blavatnik School of Government at Oxford University. Since 2012, he's also been a co-chair of the Leadership Council of the Sustainable Development Solutions Network, and he's a recipient of the Fudan Distinguished Contribution Award for Management Science. Would you please warmly welcome Professor Xue Lan.
Thanks very much for that very generous introduction. Salamat Patan. I know I'm having a much more challenging job than our colleague in the morning that at the time was whetting your appetite. Now I'm helping you to digest your food, just you just had. I think actually, first of all, I wanted to thank the foundation, and also thanks to Win for inviting me to this event. I think I've learned a great deal so far, and hopefully I will learn more, I think, later from other talks, including Jeff's. And also I want to take this opportunity to thank Jeff, because he's what this center actually is created for, and I think actually you probably didn't realize that actually we got to know each other in probably 1995 or 1996 when you did this study for Asia Development Bank. And you gave a talk in Washington, D.C., and at the time it was at GW. So I went to that event. I remembered vividly of, the conclusion of the talk is basically, if you are landlocked, then you are in trouble. If you are double landlocked, you are even in greater trouble in terms of development. But I think actually the real, so of course, the linkage is that in 2006 or 7, when there was an international commission on the development programs that actually a colleague of mine, Xiao Geng, was a member, and then we, at the time we are just starting our MID program at Tsinghua University. And so we're very fortunate to be part of the MDP program that Jeff created. And so we are really, I think, learned a great deal in our program. And of course, later that Jeff really brought me to this field of sustainable development research. In 2012, after creating the SDSM. So I think actually I'm still in the learning process, and so I hope that whatever mistake I made, please help me to correct them. I think I will talk about the policy challenge in implementing SDG, basically trying to understand and to see what are the challenges in implementing SDG. And how are China, from Chinese view in terms of implementing SDG, what are the experiences and what are the lessons to be learned? So I will basically start with a very brief introduction and then going through those challenges and then talk about China's experience, where I think it's the focus of my talk. And then I'll conclude that. I think, of course, the SDG, we've already now know the 17 goals and so on. But what are the key features of the SDG as a policy set? I think the policy process itself, I think we've already all learned a great deal. I think we are very proud that SDSN has provided, played a critical role in supporting that. I think it really enriched the concept of sustainable development and set a higher goal for human society of encompassing both economic development, social justice, and environmental protection. I think it's also a combination of top-down and bottom-up approach. I think Dan talked about this in terms of bottom-up approach. I think in a way, SDG is also, to a certain degree, combined that in involved a lot of multi-stakeholders in the policy process. So SDG is also for all countries, not just developing countries, but also many developed countries. And of course, SDG has put a lot more emphasis on the environment and so on. I think that SDG has also put a lot more focus on the tools for implementation, such as global partnership, sustainable financing, policy coordination, and so on. But I think there are many other features I think we can talk about. But in general, I think we can say from someone who studies public policy, we can say that the future generation probably will recognize that it is probably the greatest public policy experiment of our time. And I think that future generation will recognize this. But the challenge is how to implement that. Because I think in a way we can go about implementing these goals in a very sort of incremental way. But also we can do that in a transformative way. But if we really wanted to be to be transformative for the future global development, it must be implemented as a system rather than collection of individual goals. So here I think that really the first challenge is really in terms of the paradigm shift. I think actually I will talk about this later. I think in a way we can say that the previous paradigm is more of a stepwise development. So for example, I think I will talk later that people say that you develop first and then you you pollute first and then you clean up later. And there are many other misses that are related to that for development. But I think now we are really shifting to a new paradigm of simultaneity. I think for people who study econometrics and regressions, stepwise regression and simultaneous equations. So I think that paradigm shift really requires a mindset change. So are we ready for that? But that actually challenges a lot of the old wisdoms and norms. And I think, of course, that policy making is quite challenging. I think Jeff knows all this too well in terms of how to negotiate among different goals, different stakeholders, and so on. But implementation is more challenging, as John has already said. And also, I think the SDG is an integral system of human aspiration, but not separate pieces in the implementation process. Also, the goals are ambitious and complex. The complexity is already evidenced in the morning's discussion on the food, I think on energy. I think if you pick up any of these 17 goals, you will find that indeed it's the science behind it is quite complicated, and we still have a lot to learn from it. The other thing is diversity. Because I think development stages and priorities of different countries are extremely diverse and different. So how can we actually, as a global community, to implement these goals? I think it's quite difficult. The other thing is connectivity. There are many co-benefits and the contradictions among different goals. I think actually, on the food discussion we heard, I think we can certainly see there are many examples of that. And also there are many positive and probably negative spillover effects and among different implementation of different goals. So that's another layer of complexity. And the next one is capacity for implementation is limited, particularly for developing countries. I think financing, of course, we know now it's it's one challenge that in terms of implementing this goal. Green financing, I think people are concerned about after the election of Trump. So I think that's sort of, green financing has been one key challenge people are talking about. Development aid is also another one. And the government capacity in playing the role it's supposed to play is also indeed quite limited. For example, in terms of analytical capability of really designing appropriate goals, in terms of collecting the data and analyzing it and making appropriate policy, that I think is also a huge challenge for developing countries, certainly I think in China's case. And also the policy coordination within and across national borders are also difficult. Depending on the governance system, I think it's certainly in China, the central and local relationships, the vertical coordinations, and that's all quite challenging in terms of making the policy and also implementing and monitoring the policies. The policy environment is also uncertain. I think the first challenge, I think we already talked quite a bit about the this morning, is the policy, how do we communicate with the general public? I think there are some people who talked about how to communicate with young people. Indeed, I think there are generation gaps. Now, every 5 years, we have a generation gap. So in how to really get the whole public to support and to support this. And how to mobilize the general public, I think that it's the same. And how to persuade people to make current investment for the future gains, to make individual sacrifices for the greater good. Dan talked about, in terms of investment in doing research, that actually will probably be useful maybe 20, 30 years later. I think there's a governance failure here that no politician will do that. Because politicians wanted to do things that get people's support immediately in the next term, not 5, 10 years later. No less to say, 20, 30 years later. So I think that all of those challenges are indeed we have to face. And finally, but you know, the measurement is also quite a challenge, and I think SDSN has done this. In sort of working, you know, sort of trying to like a initial sort of test run in terms of generating the SDSN scoreboard, but certainly it's not easy in terms of the data in collecting the data. I think it was 143 countries were collected, but for many other countries, data was incomplete. And of course, I think we also have to be concerned about the in terms of quantitative measures and the qualitative measures, because in the policy analysis, we're often concerned about, you know, when you have some data, then tend to, you know, that measure tend to dominate, because I think we know that there are also some qualitative indicators that are as important as, you know, those measures that have data. So I think the measurement is also a huge challenge, and now there's a task force at the UN trying to resolve this problem. So all of those are indeed, I think, are the challenge that we have to face. Now I think, you know, in the morning that Dan and Angela have, you know, talked about in terms of maybe a sector, you know, the sort of energy and the food, and I'm now sort of talking about a particular case, the case of China. So I will, in the next remaining time, I will talk about the you know, implementing SDG in view of China's development process. Let me first start a review of what happened in China over the last 30 plus years. I've summarized that into four major transformations in China. The first one is the economic system. China is making the transition from planned economy to the market-based economy, and the outcome of that is a rapid economic growth, averaging about 10% until a couple of years ago. And the second is the industrial structure change. At the beginning of the China's reform, agriculture is the dominant is certainly one of the dominant sector. It's 30% of China's GDP, and the labor force more than two thirds of China's labor force are in agriculture. But today, of course, I think agriculture is less than 10%. Labor force is a bit more than one third. Manufacturing has surprisingly sort of remained quite stable, about you know, half or, you know, at least 40% of China's GDP. And that's actually part of the reason why China's emission has been quite high. Our service sector has grown quite rapidly in the recent years, and last year, for the first time, service sector has surpassed half of China's GDP. So Chinese industrial structure has made a tremendous change. And the third one is Chinese society. Like many other developing countries, Chinese society has made the transition from a rural society to an urban society. As you can see that at the beginning of the reform, at the beginning of the reform, I think actually China's, you know, so the urban population is about 20% of Chinese population. And now I think the last year, I think China's 56% of the people live in the urban areas. So the rapid urbanization process, now it's about every year, about 1% a year, which means actually in China's case, about 14 million people. And also China has also made the transition from a relatively closed society to an increasingly open society in terms of economic, you know, the economic system. As you can see that China has, during the Cultural Revolution, pretty much I think relying on itself and now becoming the largest trading partner in the world, attracting a lot of FDI and also now a lot of outward investment. People with internet access in the year 2000, I think internet was first introduced in China in 1994. And by the year 2000, China had over 225 million people have the internet access. And by the most recent account, about more than 700 million people have internet access, just about a bit more than half of the population. Another thing, of course, is overseas travel. As you can see that in the year 2000, every year about 10 million people traveling overseas, and now that number has more than 10-fold have increased. So last year, I think it's 2014, 115 million people. Now every year about 10 million people added to the number. So I think that it's indeed changed quite a great deal. And finally is the governance system. I think Chinese governance system has also made tremendous effort in changing itself to become more efficient and also to bring more participation from the general public. And I think the civil society and grassroots democracy have also grown up quite rapidly. So that is what has happened over the last 30 plus years in China. But at the same time, over the recent years, there are also increasingly more challenges that actually being brought to the attention of both in terms of domestically and globally. And the first one is the limitation of the development model is increasingly becoming more evident. Chinese economy growth in the last 30 plus years very much based on the scale expansion. And now that system is running out of steam. And also the strong government intervention also leads to many market distortions and now becoming very evident. So how do we change that? The second is that over the last 30 plus years, while the economy has grown very fast, but also the inequality has also grown. And that leads to the fragmentation of social values and also leading to many problems, including various kind of crises, and that actually the government has to deal with. And also, I think how to, in the age of globalization, how to really be integrated in the global society while at the same time maintaining indigenous capabilities. That actually is particularly evident in the area of innovation. That's also a challenge. How do you balance that? And also finally, I think resources and environmental constraint has become so evident. And so for people who are visiting China probably know that now every few weeks and you see a heavy smog and other problems. So I think in the midst, when facing this challenge, I think a lot of the Chinese academics and others began to reflect on China's development process, and which I think actually those reflections would have some also be relevant to many other developing countries. First of all, in terms of economic development, China actually started by really focusing on labor-intensive industries. And really, I think until very later on began to focus on innovation. Is that actually a necessary step? Can we actually build pathways between the cheap labor and the innovation? Because I think now, this is sort of my metaphor of a stepwise to simultaneity. Pretty much, I think China sort of bought the idea that indeed we actually start with labor-intensive industries, and then that's sort of natural step. Not until sort of later, I think probably in the mid 2000s, in 2005 and 2006, and China began to talk about indigenous innovation. Can we actually do that at the very beginning to think about that? Second, on the sustainable development, particularly with relevance to natural resource and the environment. Again, I think the mindset is that pretty much I think we pollute first and then clean up later. So in fact, I think China's sort of environmental governance system was not very well developed and not actually be very useful until the mid 2000s. In fact, we did a project on the environmental governance in the 2006, which actually proposed to elevate the Chinese Environmental Protection Bureau to the ministry level. But actually, shouldn't we do that much earlier? So I think that's the issue that actually now we can reflect on. And the third is, in terms of social cohesion, is inequality a necessary price that we have to pay to achieve economic growth? Is it possible to build a sort of much fairer sort of, you know, wealth distribution system while at the same time achieving the economic growth? So those are the sort of issues that actually now I think we are reflecting, over the China's experience, development experience. And that certainly I think that bears very much, I think, relevance to the SDGs. So I think over that reflection, I think in China's most recent five-year plan, the 13th five-year plan, China proposed the new development principles, the five major development principles. The first one is innovation-driven development. And the second one is coordinated development. And the third is green development. And the fourth one is open development. And the last one is inclusive or sharing development. So I think if you look at that, the five development principles, that really, I think, is very much linked to the underlying principles of SDG. So I wanted to talk about, now we have those principles. What are the challenges in China in implementing those principles or SDGs? And the first one, I think, as you all know, that Chinese government has played a very critical role in designing policy and implementing the policy. So I will start with the government role. How do we enhance government capability in making decisions based on sound scientific principles and broad public participations? And that's probably, I think, one of the greatest challenges. First of all, I think the government capacity, particularly at the local level, is quite limited. So how do you actually design the policy that based on many of the understanding of the scientific understanding of the issues and then to design appropriate policy particularly relevant to your local situations? And also, I think there's a deficient professional knowledge and lack of quality information that's also making it hard to make a sound policy. And the third is that insufficient institutional guarantee for orderly participation of multiple stakeholders. I think that's also a huge challenge for public policy making in China. And also the executive branch of the government to implement policies also, there are many issues, I think, in terms of the agencies, for example, many of the agencies that should play much greater role in the policy process, but they are more, they don't have enough power and to implement their policies. And also, there's inadequate consideration of environmental performance in the cadre promotion system, because I think that's a very strong incentive for local government officials, because they were promoted based on their performance in economic development, not in the environmental protection or in bringing about social cohesion. And also, I think the regulatory responsibilities are not matched with adequate resources at all levels, particularly at the local level. And also, the competencies and awareness of civil servants related to SDGs needs to be improved. The central leadership is paying great attention to SDGs, but at the local level, that's still, I think, it's being talked about at the surface. I think also the other thing is the capacity of the market to incentivize innovation and to internalize environmental externalities are also limited. I think, as I mentioned, that there's a lot of market distortion that really makes it hard for the market to play the role to provide incentives for the companies to really to internalize the externality, the environmental pollution costs. And also the regulatory system is very weak to punish the bad guys. And also the small companies, I think also, you know, now the regulatory system is paying great attention to the bigger companies, but smaller companies, I think, they don't have much incentives to be responsible environmentally. And the other thing in China is that the social organizations, there's great potential, but there's still not quite a platform for them to play the role in promoting in SDGs and to implement the SDGs. The public still lacks the knowledge and skills. Many social organizations still face many problems such as small size, inadequate funds, and the lack of skilled individuals. Many young people wanted to go to the government, wanted to go to big companies, but they do not want to go to the small social organizations. In order to address those problems, to respond to those challenges, I think in the last few years, and the government has made concerted efforts trying to get China to up to speed in implementing SDGs. So first one is through the 13th Five-Year Plan, and that actually was reviewed and approved by the People's Congress, linking SDGs with domestic mid and long-term development strategies. So actually, the UNDP did analysis of comparing SDGs with 13th Five-Year Plan. There's a very good match of the goals of the 13th Five-Year Plan with the SDG. And also, China has played a leadership role in global efforts in reaching Paris Agreement, as been mentioned this morning, and also promoted and succeeded in bringing SDGs to the G20 agenda. And they actually, in the Hangzhou Summit in this past September, actually, SDG was for the first time being brought to the G20 agenda. And now Germany is also playing the leadership role in working with many other countries, again, also to feature SDGs prominently. And also China has made great effort to publicize the agenda nationwide, but still it's not enough to mobilize the domestic resources and to raise public awareness, trying to create a favorable social environment for the implementation. Recently, China published the national plan for implementing SDG, and created a domestic mechanism for implementation of SDG. So this is a sort of inter-ministerial mechanism of 43 government agencies. China has also been quite active in the UN various mechanisms in terms of high-level thematic debates, in terms of a national review, and in terms of also the exchange development various dialogue programs. So now I will try to look at several specific cases of implementation, talking about national strategic planning, innovation, and poverty alleviation, and finally talk about the case of the university role. I think the national strategic planning is I'll use the 13th Five-Year Plan as an example because I'm a member of the National Expert Committee. China, every 5 years, China has a five-year plan. I learned that actually Malaysia also has a five-year plan as well. So maybe that we can learn from each other about this. But I think the five-year plan, I think it's not the same as the five-year plan 20 years ago, because I think at that time, China was still a planned economy where the plan is a real plan. But I think now China's five-year plan is more of a visionary document based on a very elaborative sort of process to, first of all, to illustrate the strategic intention of the country. And secondly, to clarify major economic and social development goals, major tasks and initiatives, and also to provide direction and guidelines for business and the government. So I think that's more of the role of the five-year plan. And also it's a system of of plans and initiatives in the nation. So at the national level, there's more of a national guideline. And then there are sectoral plans and the provincial and municipal plans. So those are more specific. The process, I think, is almost 2 years ahead of the data of the release of the plan, there were many prior sort of background studies were conducted. So basically, there were a commissioned study. I mean, you know, our school, myself led the team on for people doing study on the Chinese administrative system reform. And also there were two years ahead of the time, also there was an open bid for major issues listed by the National Development and Reform Commission, which is in charge of the drafting the plan. And so basically trying to solicit intellectual support from academia. And then the draft process was led by the top leadership. So last year, the President Xi Jinping was the lead, and with many senior officials, who formed a drafting group, and then many senior officials are involved, and then they went through a very elaborate sort of process in soliciting local government officials' ideas and also having round tables with some general public. And then I think once they formed the draft, and then they were sent to, again, to local government and the local officials, and also to various other groups to get feedback. And so the document was actually, the draft of the document was actually presented to the People's Congress in March 2016, and also then discussed, debated, and then revised based on the feedback, and then to be passed, and it was passed in by the People's Congress. I think the expert has played a critical role in this, and I will not elaborate on that. The second example is innovation for green transformation, the case of low carbon technology, and that actually was talked about by Dan this morning. And China, as you can see, that over the last over the years, and China has capacity. You know, in, this is the. Let me see. This print is very small. I think this is the capacity of the this is the renewable. This is the capacity. This is the case of the solar. Yeah, the solar. This is the capacity, and this equipment produced, and this is the new installations. As you can see, that has been growing quite rapidly. But four sets of the factors that played a role in getting China's low carbon technology development in China. I think first of all, I think it's the kind of research that was done a long time ago. So I really appreciate the point that Dan made that you need to make a long-term investment for the future technologies. In fact, many of the China's solar technology was actually started in the early 1970s. And actually, that actually built some really foundations for research in this area. And also, of course, the second aspect is on in terms of capabilities, manufacturing capabilities, because I think China has accumulated quite a strong manufacturing capabilities over the last 30 plus years in its economic development. So I think actually that also played a critical role in getting the industry developed very quickly. And the third is the market. And at the initial stage, China's domestic market is very fragmented, and it's not easy actually to implement this technologies. Fortunately, I think the time that actually international market became accessible after China's entry to WTO. So in fact, many of Chinese manufacturers first exported their equipment to European market, and then through that they actually gradually sort of matured their technology, and then later when the domestic environment became better, and that was then they brought the technology back to home to implement that. And then finally, I think the sort of policy also played a critical role in making the technology implementation possible. So the confluence of those four sets of factors are really shaping the evolution of low carbon technology development in China. And actually, that's we've recently completed a study with German Development Institute and so on. There's a in this year, there's an issue of science and public policy that really publishes quite a few articles by my colleagues on this issue. And the third case is a targeted efforts. It's war on poverty. I think in order to implement the SDGs, I think China began the war on poverty in 2015. In November last year, I think China had a major poverty alleviation national conference, and basically trying to set up the goals to eliminate poverty by the year 2020. So the major causes of poverty were identified. So there was a analysis of major causes of poverty. I think was basically substantive analysis of what are the major causes of the poverty. So based on that, there are five practical approach that were identified to address those problems in terms of ecological conservation, in terms of education, in terms of industrial development, in terms of social protection. So basically, there were really targeted efforts in trying to address that. And also, I think there were in different regions nationwide, what are different regions and what are the reasons, and then trying to link that. But of course, I think there are still many difficulties in really eradicating poverty in China, because I think currently, I think, there's a need for eliminating poverty for 10 million people annually. I think that's a huge challenge. And also, there were other challenges that China has to fight with. I think because of the time limit, I will not to go through this, but I think the role of university certainly is critically important. At the Tsinghua University, we've created the China Energy Modeling Forum that trying to provide analytical support for many of the policy making process. And so we've really sort of get a lot of the Chinese, academia and institutions together to exchange ideas about the modeling efforts, and also to coordinate about the the policy process and to see how the models can better support the policy process. Let me get to the conclusion. I think based on the China's experience, there seems to be some need to try to combine several things. The first of all, I think that try to combine political will with sound analysis. If we only have the political will without really scientific analysis, that probably will not translate into useful policy for implementation. The second thing is that for a country as big as China, there's a need for consistent top-level design with diversified local plans. China is just simply too big. You really can't have just one implementation plan. So you need to have the top-level design, but also you need to have more diversified local plans. And the third is that though you need to have a clear policy direction, but also a flexible implementation measures. And finally, there are some major policy initiatives. I think that we summarized into four major ones. The first one is let science lead. Basically, implementation of SDGs is complicated. So we need to rely on science, not just natural science, but also behavioral science. Behavioral science is as important. The second is empower the public. Ultimately, I think implementation of the SDG, we have to, everybody has to chip in. So we need to empower the public. And the third is incentivize business, because the business are the ones actually that have greatest impact in terms of many of the areas that we're looking at. And finally, it's to reform the government. And the government, I think, in terms of the policy, in terms of implementation, and that's actually the where also there's a huge leverage. So those are some lessons that we've learned from China's experience, and hopefully that we can learn more from many other countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Xue Lan. Sorry to shorten your time, but I think we need one conference just for China itself. And apologies for the movement, Professor Xue Lan, you must be very popular, so all the people come rushing into the hall. So let's hand it back to Professor John Thwaites.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Professor Xue Lan, for that outstanding contribution. So we have time for a few questions, and I might take two questions first and then ask Professor Xue Lan to respond.
We have noticed that there is an exponential growth of Chinese investment, whether in Western country or down here in ASEAN countries, with as much as 10% of the national GDP of the Laos being Chinese investment and Chinese spending. Is there a central government policy on that coming from China?
I'll take the second question down here.
Professor, it was most refreshing and educational to listen to your presentation. I myself, although I try and follow, I did not realize that China has made such great advances in a planning process that is democratic. Number two, I noticed also that, and I don't think others have it, we don't have it yet here, that you have a plan for the implementation of the SDGs, and that you have got a UNDP report on it. Now, if you can please elaborate on it, I think it's something we can learn from you, and the whole world can learn from you, in terms of how we go about implementing these SDGs, which has been indicated to be a major problem right through this morning. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for those two excellent questions. I think, first of all, I think on China's outward investment, I think indeed, I think in recent years, you see increasingly more outward investment of Chinese companies. I think you mentioned about whether there's a government policies in that. I think in general, I think many of those investments are sort of company-led efforts. But also, indeed, in recent years, there are indeed government efforts in supporting that is so-called the One Belt, One Road initiative that China has initiated in terms of supporting infrastructure development in those Belt and Road regions. But in general, I think it's a sort of natural stage of China's economic development. When there's increasingly more limitations in domestic market, and they're moving into the international market. The second issue on the plan of on implementation, I think actually that was the UN has led the effort in having different countries to exchange ideas and also the drafting their implementation plans, and China released its implementation plan, I think was in July this year. I think if you're interested, you know, be happy to find it and to send it to you. On the UNDP's assessment, that's initiated by the UNDP office in Beijing. So they initiated a study to look at the Chinese five-year plan and matching that with SDG. And I'm sure that the UN agency is probably doing that in different regions. And certainly, I assume that Malaysia certainly can coordinate with the UN office, probably the UN office. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Xue Lan. I think you've given us a clear policy direction. Let science lead, empower the public, incentivize business, and reform government. And given us some great case studies from China. So will everyone thank Professor Xue Lan very much.
Thank you,
Professor Thwaites. I'd like to invite you to present a token of appreciation to Professor Xue Lan. Thank you very much.